What is the difference between the rapture and the second coming of Christ? It's a question you hear a lot, so let's look at it and find out what does the Bible say. The rapture and the second coming of Christ, they're often confused. You almost think they're the same thing, and if that is what you fall into the trap of, you're going to lead and read and get confused pretty quick. You'll have passages talking about the one that you're thinking is the other, and it seems like a contradiction. Now understand something, God's word never contradicts itself. God's word is true. We can count on the reliability of Scripture. So if you think it doesn't make sense and it's not gelling and they're not going together, undoubtedly you have two separate events you're talking about. This confusion can lead to misunderstanding of what the Scripture is trying to say. So have wisdom, ask sound questions, but always go back to the authority of Scripture to understand the answer. If you have what seems like a really good teacher, but they're always telling you their opinion without the Word of God, you're getting the wrong source, because what you're getting is just opinion. We need to know what God says about the matter, the truth. These are two different events. They're separated by time and purpose. The second coming of Christ and the rapture, two separate events separated by time and the why of what's taking place. So let's first look at the rapture that takes place, and that's significant as well. And so what does the Scripture say? In 1 Thessalonians 4:13, Paul writes to the church at Thessalonica. These people, by the way, are known as Thessalonians. That's why it's termed that way. This letter he writes in verse 13 says, "But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that you sorrow not as others who have no hope." So starting off, he's saying, look, I don't want you not to understand what's going on here. I know you're confused at the moment. This is the days of the early church, and they're looking for Christ to come just any moment, just like we are today, and we're justified in feeling that way. I mean, it's been so long, his return has got to be that much closer. His rapture has got to be that much closer. Rapture comes first, by the way. So look, he's saying, don't be ignorant about this. I know you're concerned about those who are asleep. Christians, when they die, they go to be with the Lord in that imminent moment. The body remains here. And so we refer to them as simply, well, it's like they're asleep because the body's here, but they've gone to be with the Lord in that instant. And so when he uses that expression, he's simply referring to those who have already died. I don't want you worrying about them. Don't sorrow as others who have no hope, because we have a confidence, not just a earthly I wish. It's a full-fledged I can trust God moment. He continues in verse 14. He said, listen, if we believe that Jesus died and he rose again, which he did, even so, them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. So in other words, they've already gone to be with him, and when Christ comes back, he's going to bring them with him. That's what he's saying. So don't worry about it. It's okay. Verse 15, for this we say unto you by the word of the Lord. Paul is saying in one powerful moment, it's not my opinion. I'm telling you what God says. And that's the best answer from any teacher that you're going to find out what God has to say. Don't listen to the person that said, let me tell you what I think about it, because I don't care. What matters is, what does God have to say about it? That's the important truth. This we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain until the coming of the Lord, when he comes for us, well, we shall not prevent them which are asleep. The people have already died in the Lord. We're not going to stop them. Don't worry about them. They're going to get to be with Jesus as well. By the way, the Scripture says, verse 16, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. So there will be this bodily resurrection that will go up and be with the Lord in that instant. Whether that person is in the grave, whether that person was cremated, whether that person blew up in a plane crash, whatever happens, however it happened, will be caught up back together and go up to be with the Lord. And the Scripture then says, then we which are alive and remain, if he were to call us up today, that trump sounds, the dead goes up first, then you and I walk in this earth, we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. So if the rapture were to take place at this moment, the trump of God sounds, the voice of the archangel, the dead in Christ would be called up, brought up, and go up to be with him, and then we would come up. Is there a difference? Only difference I can see is they got 6 foot further to travel than the rest of us, so they get the first shot. But we will go and be with him in that moment, in that instant, the scripture says, in the twinkling of an eye. That's how fast. So, no other warnings, no other events taking place. It just suddenly, in the moment, God will give the order, the trump will sound, the dead in Christ will rise, then we, which are alive and remain, will go up with him. And so shall we ever be with him. 1 Thessalonians 4:18, wonderful message. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. That is comforting. The person that you love so dearly that goes to be with the Lord before you do, you're going to see him again. Paul just said it. God in his word just had it printed out. Guess what? Don't worry. I've got their names. I know those folks. They're coming to be with me. They know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. You will be with them again. All through history. Maybe you've got great-great-grandparents you've never met but you've heard about. You knew they were strong believers from their testimony. You're going to see him one day. That's the comfort. That's even what he's telling us. Take comfort. Comfort each other with these words of comfort. Now next, the second event, the second coming of Jesus Christ. Jesus and his army is going to come. They are going to defeat the Antichrist, which we read about in Scripture, another topic in prophecy. He's going to bind Satan, doesn't kill him off. He binds him so he can't mess with anybody. And he then establishes his millennial kingdom that often we hear about in Scripture and messages and sermons and such. Revelation chapter 19, verses 11 through 16. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he doth judge and makes war. So this is a righteous judge, a righteous warrior. His eyes were as a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. And he had a name written that no man knew but himself. Verse 13, and he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name was called the Word of God. There have been many martyrs up to this point, many people who gave their lives for the cause of Christ. And now it's going to be a very unique battle. This one labeled with the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth, this main leader, out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, and with it he should smite the nations. He will judge the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron. And he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness and the wrath of Almighty God. And verse 16, and he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You see, God, Jesus, is going to come down as this powerful warrior who's going to subdue Satan. He's going to bind him. He's going to deliver his people. He's going to bring righteousness on earth for a millennial reign. Talks about his army coming with him out of heaven. Are angels part of an army? Yes, but guess what? We are. The saints of all these prior generations saddle up and ride with him. He handles the battle just by his word, the word of God. Now, there are other exciting aspects and events in the prophetic timeline in God's word, the Bible. That's perhaps for another time. But I want you to remember, in response to the question, remember it this way. The rapture, that's Christ coming for his saints. That's when we're caught up to be with him, and so shall we ever be with him. The rapture, Christ coming for his saints. And then the second coming of Christ is Christ coming with his saints. So the rapture, we go up to be with him. So shall we ever be with him. The second coming, we saddle up and we ride with him into battle for a victorious battle where we will rule and reign with him in a millennial kingdom. And that's pretty powerful. Now, if you got a question, love to hear it. Why not send your question to us at ask@askthepastornow.com. That's ask, A-S-K, at askthepastornow.com. And always remember, through Christ, you can succeed even when others say you can't. Thank you.